Welcome to episode 295 of CPP Cast, the first podcast for C++ developers by C++ developers. I'm your host, Rob Irving, joined by my co-host, Jason Turner. Jason, how are you doing today?
I'm all right, Rob. How are you doing?
Doing okay. Any news to share?
No, I don't think so. Not at the moment. Okay.
Well, let's just jump right into it then. At the top of every episode, I'd like to hear a piece of feedback. This week, we've got a tweet from Elliot. Excellent episode. Fascinating to hear the details of reverse engineering Duke Nukem 2. I'm using the same mechanism as Duke Nukem to log, capture, and replay input events for the background playthrough on the loading screen of the hobbyist game I'm working on. And that actually kicked off a bit of a conversation between you and Nikolai, right?
Yeah, it was a fun conversation for a few minutes about also how Doom does those things, because I learned that while I was working on my C++ Doom live stream port thing, which, you know, it's funny because I never really stopped to consider how much I had actually learned during that little experiment. And it was just lots of random little details about the architecture of at least Doom. But not from the, like, how the 3D rendering was done. Like, I didn't care about that at all. I was looking at, like, the actual, like, structure of the code and how the enemies were defined and that kind of thing.
Right. Very cool. Well, we'd love to hear your thoughts about the show. You can always reach out to us on Facebook, Twitter, or email us at feedback@cpcast.com. And don't forget to leave us a review on iTunes or subscribe on YouTube. Joining us today is David Millington. David is an Australian developer originally from the island of Tasmania, where in true Aussie style, his family had a small sheep farm. Today, he lives in Northern Europe in Estonia. He began programming with a BBC microcomputer and was hired for his first programming job using C++ without ever having used it. In the week before starting work, he borrowed a copy of Strewstrip from a friend of a friend and read it cover to cover. David has a strong interest in user experience and improving what it's like to use software and programming languages. He joined Embarcadero as the C++ product manager in 2016, and today works as the product manager for both C++ Builder and Whole Tomatoes Visual Assist. David, welcome to the show.
Well, thanks very much. It's great to be here.
You must be a much faster reader than I am, because it took me like 3 or 4 weeks, I think, to read the C++ programming language.
It is a massive book. I spent all day for a week just reading it cover to cover.
Wow.
I'm not sure how much of it I actually retained, but at least when I started work, I had a bit more of an idea about C++ than when I was hired.
Right.
How did the first programming job go after reading the book cover to cover? Do you feel like that set you up fairly well for programming in C++?
I think so. I mean, it's a great book. I actually stayed with that company for something like 8 years. Yeah, it was a great place to work for.
You could publish your own book, which would be called Learning C++ in 1 Week, and it would just be a single chapter. Anyhow. I'm kind of curious about your migration or immigration from Australia to Estonia. Was that because you had a job offer in Estonia, or what? How did that work out?
Not at all, really. As traveling around about 10 years or so ago, I moved to Europe in general, and I was living in Germany for a year, and the visa expired, and I wanted to move somewhere else in Europe. And at the time, I mean, as an Australian, I'm not used to, the northern climate and, 5 months of winter and deep snow and that kind of thing. So I thought, head up off to Estonia, which I knew nothing about. Took my suitcase and boarded a plane and found a place to live, and realized it's actually a fantastic country. I love it here.
That's awesome. Yeah. That's a fun adventure for sure.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, it's a really high-tech country as well. I think that's one of the reasons I like it. It's plenty of startups here, and everyone has a digital ID card, and you can sign all your documents electronically, vote online, that kind of thing. It's it's very, very advanced country.
That's pretty cool. Yeah. And I feel like I may be confusing something now, but isn't Estonia one of the countries that has something like a digital visa or something like that to try to encourage more business and commerce coming their way too as well?
Yeah, that's right. It has a e-residency program. Okay. So I'm actually not really sure of the full details, but sure. I know it lets you start a company here. I mean, you're starting a business, you're registering a company and stuff is you're normally fairly complex wherever you are. But I know this allows anyone to do that in Estonia, so you can start an Estonian company. You know, get bank accounts, that kind of thing. And it makes it fairly painless.
Interesting.
Yeah. All right, David. Well, we got a couple news articles to discuss. Feel free to comment on any of these, and then we'll start talking more about C++ Builder, okay?
Sure.
All right. So this first one is a post from the Mozilla Hacks blog, and it's Eliminating Data Races in Firefox, a technical report. And this is all about their use of Thread Sanitizer, which I'll be honest, I was not too familiar with Thread Sanitizer before, but it sounds like a pretty powerful tool. As I was reading this, it just made me think of how, you know, Microsoft has brought ASAN to Visual Studio, and I kind of hope that they're working on bringing TSAN as well. Sounds pretty awesome.
Yeah, I was not familiar with the Thread Analyzer either, so I learned most of what I know about it by reading the article.
Yeah.
I was particularly struck, though. One thing jumped out about, I mean, I found many sort of common threading issues. But one thing that really jumped out was where code that had not been intended to be called from a, you know, I think a non-main thread has been called from multiple threads. That's a difficult situation to discover.
Yeah, and they mentioned that one about how they think it may have been, in this example, it was writing to the preference file that they use, and they think it may have been the cause of some mysterious bugs where Firefox users were reporting that their, you know, preferences were getting lost and or corrupted, and they could never reproduce it. So I think it probably was caused by this bug that Thread Sanitizer was able to find.
Yeah, it'd be very satisfying to nail down a bug like that.
Yeah. I actually have used Thread Sanitizer in the past, and when it gives you this kind of report, it's almost like magic, like to the point that you're like, well, if you just identify that there should be a mutex lock there, why don't you just, you know, tell Kling tidy and insert it for me? Because that would save an awful lot of time here.
Yeah, the report generated here does look pretty wonderful, how it just, you know, points right to, you know, the two blocks of code that are both trying to work with the same piece of data. Yeah. Sorry, go ahead.
I don't know if anything like that would be planned. I mean, integrating some of these sanitizers into Kling Tidy seems a fantastic idea.
I don't know. I've never heard anyone mention it before. I don't know what the practicality is. I feel like at the very least, it should be able to generate a diff for you, a suggested diff that you could then just apply and see if that fixed it. That could be interesting. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I think address sanitizer in some rare cases might also be able to give you similarly, like you needed to check this variable for null before you dereferenced it or something like that. But that could fundamentally change the behavior of the code too in some places if it got it wrong. I don't know. Right. I thought it was interesting that they're like going on and on. Well, from my perspective, on and on about like, oh, well, there are some things that was like, you know, a little bit of noise, things that weren't very serious, and we had to sort through all of these errors. And then you finally get down to the error count that they had to sort through, and it was 64. I'm like, you know, all things considered, that's not that many.
Yeah. And they classified some of them as being somewhat benign, but I believe they said they kind of, you know, are trying to get rid of all of them anyway, even if the ones that they feel could be benign, which sounds like a good idea, especially if it is only 64 errors.
Yeah.
I noticed in the article as well, it said that every message it gave was always correct.
Sure, yeah.
It's not always the case for these kind of tools.
Yeah, they said the tool itself, I think, guarantees no false positives, which is pretty impressive.
My understanding of how both Thread Sanitizer and the equivalent behavior for Valgrind's Helgrind tool work is that they take your multi-thread application and actually single step in a single threaded environment, like manually task switching between the threads, so that they can then say, okay, well, we just intentionally interrupted this thread at an inopportune time, is there another thread trying to access the same data? And that's how they can detect these things and be very accurate about them. It's possible I have a too high level understanding of that.
Very cool. All right, next thing we have is a short blog post on Meaning C++ blog. And this is mathematical constants in C++ 20, which I don't believe we've talked at all about when going over, you know, new features being added to C++ 20 or that are, you know, have been added in C++ 20.
Right.
But this one is, you know, mathematical constants that you probably have some macros defined for in your code, like pi and a couple others here as well.
Definitely some fun ones. I've never worked on code where I've needed these, honestly. I've needed pi like once in my whole career.
I feel like I'm always using pi, but yeah, some of these I'm not familiar with, like phi, the golden ratio. I'm not sure how that would be used in code.
Right.
Okay. I'm not sure about that one either.
Yeah.
Probably. You have to admit that adding constants like this seems a very nice small addition.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Just removes that, you know, macro that you have all over your code. Use this instead. Makes sense. All right. And then the last thing we have is an NFT-backed implementation of std unique pointer. And I don't think we've talked about NFTs at all on the show, Jason. We've certainly, I think, done an episode or two about blockchain, which relate to NFTs.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, this is pretty wild code. Do you want to tell us more about it?
I don't really know anything about, like, I know just barely enough to understand what's happening here. I understand just barely enough to get the joke, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
So an NFT was a non-fungible token.
Non-fungible token. And I believe, you know, I first heard about them a few weeks ago. They became popular. People are like buying NFTs for like popular digital art, and if you own the NFT, like that's saying kind of you own the art, even though anyone can still go and view it because it's just on the web, anyone can look at it, but by having this NFT you have some ownership of it. I don't understand the point.
No, so you can track in a secure blockchain way full ownership of your unique pointers,
right?
And so the person actually went out and implemented all of this.
Yeah.
You can create objects on the blockchain.
And I would imagine it would be very slow to run this code if you're using lots of unique pointers that have NFTs backing them. I don't think they put any stats into this.
No, there's a benchmark.
Oh, is there? Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So it says the performance overhead is negligible. Creating a unique pointer takes 0.005 seconds, and creating an NFT pointer takes 3 minutes.
Oh, it's not bad at all. Oh, that's great.
I love the tone of that readme.
Yeah.
There are jokes like that scattered through the entire thing. It's to anyone watching this, I do recommend you read it through.
Yeah, the best thing is he has a bunch of bullet points about why he's gone ahead and done this. And then after the last bullet point, it says, for more information, please read our white paper. And if you click on that link, it's a literal just white page, completely blank PDF.
That's awesome.
It's fantastic.
I should do that. That's great. And here's another bullet point that the Reddit readers pointed out. As we all know, adding blockchain to a problem automatically makes it simple, transparent, and cryptographically secure. So if you need to solve your memory problems, here you go.
Yeah. All right. So David, let's start talking about C++ Builder. And maybe we could start off with you giving us a bit of a history of the tool, because it's not something I grew up using, but I feel like a lot of our listeners probably have some experience using an older version of C++ Builder. So maybe tell us about that and how it relates to today's C++ Builder.
Sure. Well, it's great to know that you used to use it, actually. So
I didn't, but I think Jason was nodding his head.
Yeah. I was nodding my head because I know lots of people who have. I don't I've used, I think, C++ Builder very briefly a while ago, but I know lots of people, like if it comes up on Twitter, lots of people have experience with it.
Hmm. Oh, yeah, it really was, all begins with Borland, which of course was a famous name back in the day, in the 80s and 90s. And yeah, and they had Turbo C++ and so forth. And they created C++ Builder to target the, I mean, it was then Windows, but you know, to help people build, you know, UE applications. And I think still today, that's our main focus. You know, trying to help people build your normal sort of your desktop or mobile or so forth app with a user interface. I mentioned that because, of course, C++ is used often for many other things, you know, finance or data processing or scientific analysis or something that isn't necessarily directly hooked up to your a normal window. But that was the focus then, and it's still the focus now. And yeah, as you mentioned, it was really popular, I think, in the early 2000s. And the product's still widely used, I think, but not really so well known anymore.
Okay, and it's gone through a couple different companies, is that right?
Yeah.
It went from Borland to Embarcadero.
Yeah, so Borland, I don't know, changed focus and sold off its developer tools division. Oh. And that became a company called Codegear, and that was bought by Embarcadero.
Okay.
And all this happened, I think, in the late 2000s. Well before I joined the company, so I'm trying to remember the history here. And then in 2015, Embarcadero was bought by Idera. Now, Idera is a very large, actually, software company based in Texas, and owns a number of developer tools companies. It owns Hortomato as well, which make Visual Assist, which I also work with. Centure. Travis CI, whole bunch of different sort of tools like this.
Oh, okay.
And basically when they bought Embarcadero, Embarcadero has sort of two main tools. So there's Delphi as well, which again, I guess many listeners are familiar with, especially from the early 2000s when it was very popular.
That's a genesis from Turbo Pascal onward to Delphi, right?
Very much, yeah. So okay. Delphi effectively added object orientation to Turbo Pascal, and built a beautiful UE library called the VCL as well, which wraps the native Windows WinAPI layer. And actually, that library is usable from within C++ Builder as well, because our dialect of C++ can interop with the Delphi language. You can even write a C++ class that inherits from a Delphi class. And at the time when Idera acquired it, Delphi had a product manager and so forth, but they were looking for someone for C++ Builder, and that's when I joined about 5 years ago.
Okay. I feel like it's worth maybe just taking a second here to so you said the Turbo products a lot of people are familiar with, and certainly like anyone who was programming in the 90s for sure knew Turbo C++. There's no question. And Turbo Pascal. And so these tools are, that's just, if you, Turbo C++ was being developed, it just kept being developed, and now you have what you have today. Is that fair to say? Like, is it the same history, lineage?
Well, not quite, because in the Borland days, the C++ compiler, the one we call internally, we call the classic compiler now, the Borland C++ compiler, came from that lineage. But around 2010, when C++ 11 was around the corner, the development team was looking at some of the stuff that was coming in C++ 11 and realized that, especially with the changes in template handling and so forth, that the old C++ compiler code base was really not viable to take forward to modern C++. And so we switched to using Clang, So what we use today, we still provide the old compiler.
Okay.
Not very many people use it, but you know, some people still have projects based on it, and you know, of course it's got a history.
Wow. So is that like only C++ 03 supporting compiler?
That's right. Yeah, okay. And a few things from C++ 11 that could be implemented, but right. Yeah, you generally just disregard it as C++ 03. But what we did then instead was to take Clang and to add our language extensions and so forth to Clang. So when you install C++ Builder today and you create a new app and compile, you're actually using a slightly modified version of Clang instead of the lineage from the old Borland tools.
So you have to maintain your own patch set on Clang.
We do, yes. And it's quite an extensive patch set as well. I mean, we add quite a few language extensions. So the patch is mostly in the front end, not in code generation, but yeah, there's quite a significant amount of work there.
So, I mean, I keep bringing back that interview with Patricia Oss last time she was on, Rob, but she was working on building her own Chromium-based browser, which has its own patch set as well. And apparently these large projects, particularly those that have influence from our friends at Google, tend to not be very stable ABI kind of code bases, and the patch sets are difficult moving targets. I'm just kind of curious, like, how much effort does it take to maintain your patch set so that it can still be applied to the next version of Clang?
Well, actually, it takes quite a bit. There's an interesting question because we've been discussing internally about changing our approach to how we maintain this.
Hmm.
So what we tend to do is we tend to pick a version of Clang and stay on it for a couple of years before moving forward to another version, which can be unfortunate because, you know, we have a couple of years worth of Clang changes that we don't make available to customers. But it does mean we can sit with a single version and, you know, ensure it's, you know, rock solid.
Right.
Yeah, there's quite a wide variety of changes, and what I've been told by the developer team is that Clang can often, and I wish I could speak with more authority about this because I'm not a compiler engineer, so you know, this is kind of secondhand, I'm afraid. But what I'm told is that often Clang does make, you know, fairly major internal changes that can make porting code forward quite difficult. And that tends to be what we do. I mean, you know, we merge our changes in through Git and, you know, track the changes forward. But every so often something has, you know, sort of changed that requires quite a large amount of work. So we're thinking, you know, internally about our next sort of stable version of Clang that we'll pick for the next couple of years, and whether we should take that approach of merging forward or take a different approach, which might be, you know, rather than trying to merge the patches, try to write some of the features anew. One of the reasons for that is that, you know, as Clang changes, the right way, you know, the best way to write something changes as well.
Right.
And that would let us take advantage of, you know, doing something new, doing it the, you know, in the past it was the right way to do it one way, but, you know, now it might be better to implement a different way.
In the past, I've tried to take where other people have created like a Z80 backend or a 6502 backend or something for Clang, and try to say, okay, well, can I apply this to the current Clang fork, develop fork branch or whatever? And if that patch set is more than like a year old, it seems like it's virtually impossible. And that's just on a tiny back end. So I can only imagine what you all have to deal with.
Yeah, it does get quite complicated. I think, yeah, a year there is probably a good good estimate of when the churn becomes very large. And we tend to go over a couple of years worth of versions as well. It is doable. It just takes a reasonable amount of work. I mean, this is, you know, several months worth of work to do that.
Right.
Right. So do you want to talk more about the C++ extensions you're putting into the language to make all this necessary? What types of extensions are there?
Oh, sure. Well, they're extensions for a couple of reasons. One of them is, as I mentioned, we make Delphi as well. And you know, Delphi and Pascal and Object Pascal is quite a different language to C++, especially in the past 10 years or so. I think they've sort of diverged. You're in the, not really sure what to call it, the I know the mindset of language design has changed quite a bit. And so some of our extensions assist with the interop there. So there are Delphi language features that we want to make available to C++ developers. The other reason for some of the extensions is simply that it allows a different approach to, I guess, library development or consuming libraries than is normally possible in C++. So an example here would be to do with our UE libraries. This kind of crosses over both because the frameworks that we make available, I'm focusing on user interface here, but you know, we have many other things in the RTL, sort of a bit like Qt. I mean, Qt has a very large RTL that they provide, you know, with their own string implementation and so forth. And we do the same, you know, with our own, you know, strings and JSON and REST and so forth. All of those are actually written in Delphi.
Wow.
The Delphi compiler emits a C++ header. And you include that C++ header and then just link against the Delphi object files. So from the point of view of a C++ compiler, it has no idea that it's speaking to anything that's not C++. You know, it has a perfectly valid C++ header, and you know, the linker is perfectly happy, and you know, it all works rather well.
Interesting.
But an example, I think. Sorry, I sort of went off track there.
No, that's fine.
Explaining that. Yeah. Would be adding properties. So properties are something that have never been in C++. But if you're developing something like a UE library, then they're very, I don't know, useful idiom. You know, to set and get state, and sometimes to cause. You're usually setting, but sometimes getting to have an action occur as well. You might have a property like caption, for example, that represents the, you know, the window title.
Mm-hmm.
And so property allows field like semantics to that. So you can just, you know, access it like a field. You know, it looks like a field in code. You have your pointer to the window arrow caption, and you know, you can assign a string to it or read a string to it.
Okay.
But of course, when you set the window caption, you actually want something to happen under the hood. And so the assignment there, you know, isn't just a field assignment, but it actually invokes a method. And you know, that looks after the actual work of you know, changing the window text.
Interesting.
Right. So when working on some of these extensions, have you ever considered trying to bring them back into standard C++? I have a feeling that properties has probably at least been thought about by the standard committee, and I know there's the whole metaclasses proposal. But have you ever considered kind of bringing that work back into standard C++?
We have. It's interesting you mention metaclasses because we have those as well. A very light implementation, but we use metaclasses to allow virtual construction. Because in C++, okay, a constructor is not virtual.
Right.
Actually, before I answer the question, I think it's worth mentioning one other extension as well, which is misnamed today, but it's called a closure. Which is a way of capturing an object-oriented method pointer. So the syntax is very C-like. It's like a C method pointer, but you know, it captures the you know, object reference that the method is going to be called on as well. as I said, Clojure is kind of misnamed because, you know, it doesn't really capture more than that, but that's history. And those are very useful for events. And again, we get back to UE programming because something happens, you know, you click on a button and you want something to occur. And this idea of capturing an object-oriented method pointer allows you to delegate the behavior. So your button will store a pointer to the method that you want called when your button is clicked.
Right.
And that can be anywhere. It doesn't have to be in any specific button class or window class. So this set of things, the property method event model was actually proposed back in about 2002, I think. And I went and looked up the papers. So if anyone's interested, then the pre-Santa Cruz meeting in 2002, we added proposed N1384, just in case anyone wants to look that up.
2002, wow, okay.
Yeah. And shortly after that, so I'm just flipping through tabs here. In 2004, there was a proposal for C++ CLI by David van der Voorde.
Mm-hmm.
And apologies if I mispronounce that.
I think that's pretty close.
Yeah.
Great. Of course, Microsoft was working on C++ CLI back then as well. And they I don't want to speak on their behalf, but I think they wanted properties for much the same reason. Because it allows a different sort of programming model. That one is N1600. Then there was another paper, N1615, which actually was quite critical of the idea of properties, that they weren't very C++-ish. And this is the last that I can find in the standards committee papers. Now, this is still 2004, so it is long, long before I ever got involved. And, I can't speak with authority to what happened. But it looks to me as though this particular last paper was influential and sort of killed the idea of adding properties to C++.
It happens from time to time. Yeah.
It does.
I'm curious what killed it. I need to go and find and read that paper.
if we can try to get point. All those, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it does have some good points. I think the main point of the paper was that properties and events are very useful for a specific type of programming, specifically UE libraries,
mm-hmm.
But they can be misused. And the paper seems to be concerned about that misuse. One reason there is that the action of setting what appears to be a field, I mean, you address it in code like a field, has side effects because it could invoke a method. And you can certainly see how that could lead to badly architected applications or unexpected behavior or something like that. So that's certainly a valid concern. For me, I think we tend to think that the benefits outweigh the risks there because it does allow very elegant code, but I think like everything, you need to use it in the right place in the right way.
Right.
I'm kind of curious because, this event-driven GUI development thing, QT has their signals and slots mechanism, mm-hmm. which sounds pretty similar. But whenever I hear a conversation about event-driven asynchronous behavior, it seems like coroutines keep coming up, even not necessarily C++ 20 coroutines. But I was just curious with all these language extensions you're talking about, if you had anything like a coroutine from before or not.
We don't know. When I say events, I think perhaps it's a smaller definition than sure. is often sort of meant by the term today. So it's not asynchronous. When an event is called, it happens in the UE thread.
Okay.
But I think coroutines would potentially be quite useful in some ways, but it's definitely not something that we've ever looked at.
So this is like a button is clicked and you want to notify these other three widgets that a button was clicked, kind of, or controls or whatever. Is that the of event you're talking about? Okay.
Yeah, pretty much. And an event here really means calling a method. When something happens, and the when is the event.
Okay.
Call a method via this this method pointer.
Okay. So when we first started off talking about C++ Builder, you mentioned that it's kind of based on Delphi and mostly used for UI development. Is it specifically for UI development on Windows, or is it a cross-platform targeting application?
Our main focus is on Windows.
Okay.
So at the moment, you can build apps for iOS as well.
Yeah.
For a while, we supported Android as well. We're considering adding that back, but there wasn't actually a great amount of demand there. I think we may in future go back to Android and macOS and even Linux as well. The main sort of interest is for Windows development.
Okay. And since you're using your modified version of the client compiler, are you on a pretty new version of C++? Are you targeting like C++ 14, 17, 20?
C++ 17 at the moment.
Okay.
And I mentioned earlier that we sort of tend to pick a version of Clang and regard that as our sort of stable release for a while. And obviously with C++ 20 out, we want to upgrade.
Right.
We're considering when and how to do that at the moment. Currently it's C++ 17.
I feel like if your next goal is C++ 20, based on current compiler conformance to the standard, you should wait a little while before investing the effort, that is. Because the current compiler is going to be a moving target, but anyhow.
Right.
I'm curious to go back, if you don't mind, to this Delphi C++ integration. So you said your Delphi compiler just emits a C++ header file that can be consumed by Clang.
Mm-hmm.
So first question is, does that go both ways? Can I consume a C++ header from Delphi and use an object from C++?
Not really, no. You definitely can't consume a C++ header.
Okay.
And I think the main reason for that is that a lot of constructs in C++ that there is no equivalent for in Delphi.
Okay.
Whereas I think something like 98% of Delphi has constructs that can be that have equivalents in C++. So that makes it a lot easier to go in that direction. But there are ways to achieve it. For example, often when Delphi developers want to make use of C++, they'll write an interface in Delphi. That interface, that the unit with the interface in is compiled and becomes a C++ header with, C++ doesn't have interfaces per se, but you can have a pure virtual and so forth.
Right.
And then write a C++ class that inherits from that. And does whatever you want in C++. But the Delphi code will talk to a Delphi interface and be completely unaware that the implementation of that interface is actually in C++.
Okay. So does this imply then that your Delphi compiler uses the same object layout and calling conventions from a ABI perspective as the C++ compiler?
It does, yes. And actually, some of this is the work that we need to do as well. In terms of modifications to Clang.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
So I focus mostly on extensions because I think extensions are quite interesting to modify the C++ language. Well, not modify, it's a superset. Delphi has on Win32, for example, it has a different calling convention. A register calling convention, that you know other compilers don't implement, for example. And so you know we add that to Clang. And a few other interesting things as well. I mean, Delphi is a a different approach to language design, I think. So for example, some of it some of its types you could refer to as managed. So a string, for example, is reference counted and copy on write. And things like this, like string and some other sort of inbuilt high level primitive data types, like we have one called currency, or a date time one, and a few other things like that. We actually have special ABI support for as well.
Built into your front end.
Yes.
Interesting. Okay. I'm kind of curious what that looks like. Why do you need to build that into the C++ front end instead of being able to consume the header files emitted from?
Well, the header file will simply say that there's a string parameter, for example. These types, I mean, the majority of things in Delphi are just classes or structs or so forth. And they just have a header version emitted. Okay. But some of these things are sort of inbuilt types to the Delphi compiler, and I think string's a really good example there.
Okay.
So in Delphi, string is a Unicode string. It's wide character string, and it's, as I mentioned, sort of reference counted and copy on write. And there's no sort of header translation of that because it's an inbuilt primitive in the compiler.
Okay.
Now we actually write a C++ class that implements exactly the same thing and is layout compatible.
Okay.
And so when you include the headers for our RTL, you'll include a header for that string class. And so we have a C++ implementation, basically, that it is actually what's used when you use this Delphi type in C++. But because it's layout compatible in memory and so forth, Delphi will consume a string that was created in C++ unaware that it wasn't the Delphi compiler primitive version.
You're like, here's some bytes, trust me.
Exactly, yeah. Going along with this is that these sort of inbuilt compiler primitive types, it varies depending on the type, but some of them have some special semantics around how they're passed into a method.
I see.
So that's the kind of thing that we need to add.
So currency, the one that you brought up, it's fair to say that's actually a primitive in Delphi.
Yes, that's right.
Okay, I missed that the first go around. That's very interesting.
Well, I may not be explaining things very well, and my apologies for that.
That's fine.
Drink more caffeine.
And I haven't had any yet today. So ABI stability in C++ is something that we've brought up a lot on this show over the last few months. And it sounds like you all have to be concerned not just with ABI stability in your own code, because it's being shared between the things, but you also have like a cross-language ABI stability. Although I guess on the other hand, if you needed to ever change the layout of currency, you control the whole ecosystem anyhow. So you can just be like, yeah, we changed it, it's fine, and change it on both sides.
Yeah, that's right. And we tend not to change the ABI very often. In fact, we've only made one change in the whole time as I've been product manager.
Wow.
And in one sense, as you say, yes, I mean, we control everything. So here we have our C++ compiler engineers and Delphi compiler engineers, and obviously, work together and make the change. But it's, never quite as simple as that, because an ABI is a complicated thing.
When you're on a project and you're, building your application, are you typically building everything from source, or are library like components being passed around a lot that, breaking ABI would be a huge problem?
Well, Actually, there are a couple of answers to that.
Okay.
On the Delphi side, the compiler engineers keep ABI compatibility between major releases. Now that's the ABI, not in terms of how a parameter is passed to a method, calling convention or so forth, but the ABI in terms of the layout of a data structure and something like that. And so the flexibility we have there is that we can change the internals of class that affect layout and other things like that. Add methods, remove methods, so forth, every major release. So that's one form of ABI. And so that means that every major release, of course, you need to recompile your source fully.
That sounds fair. Minor
releases, you don't have to. Yeah. on the C++ side, we're a bit more flexible. We actually give ourselves the flexibility to make changes even between minor releases.
Oh,
okay. And I think the reason for that is that we found that our C++ developers are much more happy just to rebuild when they install a minor update than the Delphi developers are, which is great because it gives us a lot more flexibility. You can constantly sort of iterate and improve much, much faster there.
That sounds to be the exact opposite of experience of what the standards committee has been discussing. Since they have voted to not break ABI compatibility within the C++ 20 timeframe, I think C++ 23 might still be open for discussion. But yeah,
I did read that, but I'm not quite certain of the reason. Do you know why?
My understanding is that the reason is they don't want to fracture the language, kind of, because if they break ABI compatibility, then it might get people stuck on older compilers because they're relying on older binary blobs, DLLs, whatever of some sort that they can't rebuild.
Hmm.
That is my understanding. I should probably go back and look at some notes because I've been thinking about this a lot the last couple of days.
That makes a lot of sense. And it is interesting that it's kind of the opposite to our experience, as you mentioned.
Yeah. I think it comes down a lot to say if someone has a DLL that controls some proprietary piece of hardware and they don't have access to the source code to that, and perhaps the company's even gone out of business that provided it to them in the first place, then now if they upgrade their C++ compiler or upgrade their standard library implementation, they can no longer control their $100,000 piece of equipment or something like that. From my perspective as an outsider, I feel like if you're relying on a piece of software that you don't have the source code to and it's decades old anyhow, you're kind of already up the creek.
Yeah, you're probably not the type who's worried about upgrading to the new compiler anyway. Yeah,
it's possible I'm exaggerating or taking too high a level of the... But does that sound about right from what we've heard on the show, Rob?
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah.
It seems to come up about every third episode or so for some reason or another.
So, David, we've talked a lot about kind of the internals of C++ Builder. Do you want to tell us a little bit more about the types of applications that developers are typically building with it and what types of tools C++ Builder is giving developers to make that easier?
Sure. As I mentioned, I think one of the main reasons developers use C++ Builder is because of the UE frameworks. So we have our main Windows UE framework called the VCL and also a cross-platform one called FireMonkey. I think we make hooking up UEs to code easy. It's not always something that has been easy in C++. Qt makes it easy as well, I think. And they have the same problems that we do. In terms of C++, you're not really quite supporting the models that are needed for this kind of thing, and they obviously take a different approach to the solution. To paint with a broad brush, the average C++ Builder app, it would be a Windows UE application. But beyond that, it's hugely varied. I mean, you know. software in, I don't know, science, you know, the many sort of scientific apps and analysis, you know, apps written in C++ Builder. There's some, you know, software for industrial automation. There's some even software that works in power plants. There's some, you know, desktop software that the people sort of sell, you know, the kind of software that you run on Windows that you might buy yourself. There's, you know, it's sort of too broad to even really be able to pin down. Yeah, there's trying to think now, and now I'm on the spot, and I've forgotten, but there are definitely apps that you've probably used, you know, on Windows that are written in C++ Builder.
Okay. So does it, you have implemented your own GUI controls, you take that approach, right?
Yes.
So just out of curiosity, because it's been a while since you say that there's lots of apps, and I believe you. I'm just kind of curious if you, as the one of the team developers, if you can pull up an app and be like, oh, yeah, this was definitely a C++ Builder app because I know the feel that our widgets have, our components have.
Sometimes. Look, on Windows, it's much harder because when I say we write our own controls, they wrap the Windows APIs.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, it feels like a Windows app.
All right, cool.
You know, of course, you can write your own controls as well.
Right.
And there are some quite common controls in our ecosystem that, you know, you sort of recognize. You know, you pull up an app and you think, oh, okay, that particular tree view is probably a virtual tree view, which is, you know, the name of one of our, you know, the very popular third-party components or something like that. I think on mobile it's easier because for the cross-platform framework, we do write our own widgets from scratch. And, okay. You know, we try very hard to, you know, mimic the application look and feel. And actually for some controls, like on iOS, for example, you can choose whether a text import is our version or, you know, the native version. Hmm. Of course, if someone chooses to have the native version, then you can't tell.
Right.
But, yeah, we do try to get very close to the native look and feel as well.
Cool.
So even that can be hard. And I think there's one reason for that is that we value you know, helping developers create interfaces that feel right on whatever platform they're on. And a good part of being right is being or feeling right to a user of an app is sort of being indistinguishable in behavior from every other app on the platform. Which, you know, if we meet that target, then we've done a good job. But it makes it hard to answer your question about being able to tell that an app is built with C++ Builder.
No, I think that answered my question perfectly because I was curious, like WX Widgets uses as much as possible the native with components underneath, which it sounds like that's similar to what you're doing. And it can be very difficult to tell the WX app sometimes. And Qt depends on how they've skinned it or whatever. And yeah, you did answer my question. So that's pretty cool. Sounds like it has a nice native feel.
Yeah. That's certainly what we aim for. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. If listeners are interested in trying out C++ Builder, is there a free demo or is it available for like open source or anything like that?
Yeah, there is. It's not open source. It's a commercial.
Some like products might be available for free if you're like an open source developer or something like that.
Yeah, we have a community edition that's quite similar to the Visual Studio community. But that's actually running about one release behind at the moment. We plan to update that soon. So actually right now I'd suggest not checking out the community one because it's, you know, not really up to date. You know, with what we're offering at the moment. There's a trial version and currently a 30-day trial, but I think we're planning to extend that to a 90-day trial very soon. So possibly by the time this is, you know, live and broadcast, there'll be a 90-day trial. And that's just embarcadero.com and you know, the products menu and, you know, C++ Builder is listed there and there's a, you know, free download there.
Okay. Very cool. Well, is there anything else you want to go over before we let you go, David?
Um, Well, I think I could talk about some of the internals and the things we do for hours, and I hope I haven't sort of talked too much or kind of waffled off topic a little
for any of your questions. No, not at all. It was interesting. Yeah.
Well, I'm glad you found it interesting. I don't think there's probably not much else to cover today. I hope that people would find C++ Builder interesting. I mean, if you used it in the past, to check it out again. IDEA is quite committed to its C++ tools. I mean, as I mentioned, C++ Builder is not the only C++ tool that it owns. There's Visual Assist, for example. And so, it's not well known, but it's there and steadily getting updates and work done on. And who knows, maybe I can come back in a year and tell you about some more.
Sure.
Some point after C++ 20 support has been finalized or something.
Sure. Yeah.
All right. Well, David, it's been great to have you on the show today.
Well, yeah, I really enjoyed it and I really appreciate the invitation. So thank you very much.
Thanks for coming on.